Hi there, this is Harry and welcome back to Advanced English Lessons with Harry, where we try to help you to get a better understanding of the English language. We help you with phrasal verbs, expressions, idiomatic expressions, everything that you could possibly need to improve your English, to help you with better conversational English, to help you with better business English, or indeed if you're just practicing for those proficiency exams or preparing for a job interview, you've come to the right place. As you know by now, I'm a great advocate of one-to-one lessons as the best way in which you can improve your language skills. So let me tell you about Preply. Preply is the complete solution for effective language learning. A one-to-one tutor platform where you can learn quickly to improve your speaking skills. Preply has thousands of tutors that are native Spanish, French, Portuguese, English, in fact, over 50 other languages. They have over 32,000 tutors that you can choose from to make sure that you select the perfect fit for you, and you can use their filters to narrow down your choice. You can take lessons anytime, find the perfect time for your busy schedule and book lessons in seconds using their desktop or mobile app. Let's be honest, how many times have you paid for an app to learn something new that you've never finished? With Preply, you can enjoy an individual approach and learn a new language from real expert tutors based all around the world. With Preply's 100% satisfaction guarantee, they will replace your tutor if your first tutor, for some reason, doesn't meet up to your expectations. Isn't it about time you tried Preply? And remember to click on the description below to make sure that you get your 50% off the first lesson that you purchase with Preply.com. Thanks, Preply, for sponsoring this lesson. Okay, so let's get on with this particular lesson. As I said, this is an advanced English lesson, and in this lesson, we're looking at advanced adjectives. So why do we use them, and why am I giving you these advanced adjectives? Well, one, it will enhance and improve your vocabulary, which is really, really important, particularly if you're taking proficiency exams, or indeed if you are at that intermediate level and you want to get on from B2 to C1, you're really going to need to improve your vocabulary, broaden it as much as possible. Gets a little bit boring to use the same adjectives: big, clever, tall, light, thin, fat, whatever. We want to look at other ways in which we can use descriptive language, okay? So what I've got for you are 20 adjectives, and I'm going to give you examples of when you can use them. So advanced adjectives, I accept they can be a little bit difficult, but you know, it's a great way for you to broaden your horizons and improve your vocabulary and your expressions. Number one, biased. Okay, and just be careful also with the pronunciation, biased. Here's an example. In 2018, a group of scientists published results suggesting face recognition is biased, okay? And we often use biased with the preposition towards. For example, she was biased towards her brother, or in favor of her brother, so she refused to believe that he had could have stolen anything from his classmate, okay? So she was biased towards, or indeed in favor of, her brother, so she refused to believe that he could have stolen anything from his classmate. Okay, so biased. Next, blunt. Blunt. Now, sometimes people get this confused with bland. The two very different adjectives. Bland means plain and simple, okay? Bland, something that tastes bland, you know, like white bread, very bland. Or a picture with no color on it, very bland. Here we're talking about blunt, and it has a couple of ways in which we can use it, blunt. So if you're writing with a pencil and there is no point on the end of the pencil, then it will be blunt. You're not able to write clearly or draw professionally with it because the point is blunt and you have to sharpen the point. Or indeed, if you have a blunt knife in your kitchen, which I have many of, they won't be able to cut meat. Okay, so you cannot cut or slice meat with a blunt knife. You have to sharpen the knife. So sharpen the point on the pencil, sharpen the knife, so the knife will cut through the meat, it will no longer be blunt, and the pencil will allow you to draw nicely, neatly, professionally, because you've got a nice point and it's no longer blunt. Now, the other meaning of blunt is how we talk to people. When we talk to people in a blunt way or a blunt manner, it means we are very, very rigid and we're very straight to the point and can sound a little bit rude. Okay, so the manager made a blunt remark about the future of the company. He said the company will not survive another 3 months. That's very, very blunt. He didn't say there's a possibility or we might be successful. He was very blunt and said this company will not survive another 3 months. So blunt can be exactly that. It's straight to the point without any colour about it, and people can get a little bit upset that we are so blunt. Okay, so when we are blunt, we might say something that could hurt other people's feelings. So we have to sometimes soften the blow a little bit. And please remember to click on the link in the description below to make sure that you get your 50% off on the first lesson that you purchase with Preply.com. Number three, compelling. Okay, compelling. When something is compelling, it keeps your attention or keeps your focus. So, for example, this book was well written and the story was compelling, meaning it kept my attention or my focus. The lecture that the professor gave was very compelling, or he provided compelling evidence to the police. So the evidence he gave really, really told the police or explained to the police very easily what had happened. So it was very compelling evidence. We can give compelling reasons why we should get a day off. So we go to the boss and tell him, I want to take Thursday off. So the boss says, why? And then you give him a compelling reason. Well, I have to go to the funeral of my aunt, my nearest and dearest aunt. She looked after me for many years when my mother was sick. And that's a compelling reason why your boss will give you a day off to go to the funeral. Compelling. Number four, conceited. Well, people who are conceited often are people that have a better opinion of themselves than most people have. And maybe their opinion of themselves is a bit higher than what their actual abilities are. The student is very or was very conceited. He thought no one would get or should get a better grade than he did. Okay, so he was very conceited, had a conceited opinion, a belief that he was better than other people, when in fact he really wasn't. He was conceited and arrogant. So those words often go together to describe the actions or the characteristic of a person. Conceited, that again, he believed that he didn't need these other people around him. He was so conceited, he believed that he was good enough to solve all of the problems. Conceited and a little bit arrogant. Daunting. Well, daunting is a lovely word to use. Daunting means that something is a little bit difficult, not impossible, but a little bit difficult. So challenges are often very daunting. So what's the point of a challenge unless it is daunting? You know, to climb that mountain, to run that marathon, to win that race, to do whatever you want to do as a challenge to prove yourself, then it has to be a daunting prospect, a daunting task. The task that the boss set me took many, many days, and it was really daunting at first, but I did achieve it and he was satisfied. Europe is facing a daunting economic challenge with rising inflation and costs out of control and escalating fuel and energy costs. So a daunting challenge for the ministers and the prime ministers and presidents of the various members of the European Union as they face into yet another year of economic uncertainty with rising inflation, much heavier fuel costs and wage demands. So a very daunting challenge that they have to face up to. Difficult, but not impossible. Number six, defiant. Well, when somebody is defiant, they stand up against all of the odds. They stand up against bullies. They refuse to give in. They don't want to appear to be weak, or they don't want to give up without a good fight. So they are defiant. They wanted him to resign because of poor performance, but he was defiant and he wanted to struggle on. Now, that could be the football manager when the team is really struggling to get any good results. They're not winning any games. And so all of the press are talking about how long is he got left in the job. The spectators and fans are calling for him to quit. And you get the usual song in the ground, you're getting sacked in the morning. And so he is defiant, though, that he will not resign. He will fight on. The team will improve. And it's only a question of time. They're just out of luck at the moment. So very defiant. Or the demonstrators were determined to overthrow the government. They were defiant against all the odds. Defiant. Number seven here. Now, be very careful with our pronunciation here. So the word is excruciating, excruciating. So something that's excruciating, we usually refer to as something painful. The pain was excruciating when I broke my arm, or when I broke my leg, or I broke my hand. So somebody who has a fall in the ice or the snow and they break their arm or their wrist, the pain will be excruciating for several hours until they get to the emergency department of the hospital. They get it strapped up, indeed, probably into a plastic cast. Okay, so excruciating meaning very, very painful. Listening to my wife sing is excruciating. Literally, it is. She can't sing, but listening to my wife sing is excruciating. It's painful on my ears. Painful on my ears. I pulled the bathroom door on my toe and the pain was excruciating. I did that many years ago and I pulled the nail off my big toe. Not a pretty sight. So excruciating. Something really, really painful. Oh, ow. Very painful. Number eight. Again, be careful with the pronunciation here. Exhilarating, exhilarating. So this is something really, really exciting. Yeah, okay. When something is exhilarating, it lifts your spirits. Watching a Formula One race, not for me, but for other people, find it very exhilarating. The noise, the acceleration of the cars, vroom, vroom, vroom. They find that exhilarating, really exciting. We played a new game at Christmas that we bought, a new board game called Carcassonne. It was exhilarating. Have you tried it? If you haven't, you should. It's a really, really good game. We really enjoyed it. Exhilarating, really interesting and exciting. I climbed to the highest peak of those mountains. At last I got there. I hadn't been able to succeed. It was truly exhilarating, really exciting. Another word, again, be careful with the pronunciation here. Number nine, exuberant, exuberant. So we've had three words now in a row with the using EX. Excruciating, meaning painful. Exhilarating, really exciting. And now exuberant, exuberant. Okay, so this could describe about lots of different things. Young kids, when they are running around and they are excited and they're waiting for Christmas, they are exuberant. Yeah, they are full of energy. Yes, so the grandparents can't keep up with them. So my grandchildren are continuously running around and chasing each other. They are exuberant. Okay, so it's the sunshine makes you feel exuberant. You wake up in the morning, you get outside, you want to go for a jog, a long walk, stretch your legs, feel that warm sunshine on your back. Exuberant. Okay, and a number 10, fierce. Okay, fierce. Now, this is an adjective we use to describe lots of different things. For example, wild animals can be described as fierce when they're dangerous. You know, the fierce growl of the howling of the wolf in the forest. Okay, so that could be fierce. Or if you met two or three wild dogs in the park, they're not, you know, they're domesticated, but they're running around free and they could be a little bit frightening. And if they start growling at you, they can sound fierce, okay? or the wind or the cold can be fierce when you go out and it's -3 or -5 degrees and there's a really, really cold wind blowing. The wind was fierce. It was really, really cold. So weather conditions can be described as fierce, a fierce storm at sea and the high waves that threaten to sink the ships and cause flooding around the coastal areas. This can also be described as fierce weather conditions. Okay, well, we've reached the halfway mark. We've got 10 down, 10 to go. Now on to number 11, and the word is flimsy. Flimsy means something really, really light, very easy to tear, like a flimsy dress or a flimsy bit of paper. So easy to blow away in the wind, and the dress that's flimsy, easy to tear, you have to be really, really careful with it. Okay, so the paper bag was very flimsy. It burst and all my shopping fell onto the floor, onto the ground. So when you have a flimsy bag and you put too much in it, a couple of kilos of potatoes and something else, and it rips, very flimsy bag. They don't make bags like they used to, okay? Or the bedclothes were very flimsy and in nighttime it was really chilly. So you need to get out that winter duvet. It's nice and snug. Snug as a bug in a rug. Yeah, so we get the bedclothes were very flimsy. I froze during the night. Okay, so flimsy, light, thin, not holding much heat. Number 12, formidable. Now be careful again with the pronunciation here, formidable. It's not such a difficult word, but you need to pronounce it clearly. Formidable. An opponent in a boxing match can be described as formidable if he's very strong and tough. If you ever watched the Rocky movies, his opponents in the boxing ring were always formidable, and Rocky always stumbled and stuttered, but eventually he won. Of course he did. He always won. So, but in the movies, the contestant or the opponent was formidable, strong, tough, and somebody very difficult to beat. It was a formidable challenge, but I finally finished that marathon crossword puzzle. Usually at the end of the year in some magazines or newspapers, you get a crossword puzzle 3-4 times the size of the normal ones, and they're quite a formidable challenge, quite difficult to complete. But if you've got spent plenty of time over the holidays, well, of course, then you can really, really enjoy it. So formidable. Number 13, foul. F-O-U-L, foul, okay? So as an adjective, we're using this foul. Yeah? So a foul can be a bad smell. So many of the time when you go into shopping centres or pubs in particular, and you want to use the loo, the smell in the toilets, particularly the gents' toilet, is a foul smell, a bad smell. Or if you come home from holidays and you forgot to empty the fridge when you open it, oh, there's something in there that smells bad. It's a foul smell. Rotten eggs, musty butter or stale bread, whatever it might be, there is a foul smell. But we can also refer to foul as the mood somebody might be in. She was in a foul mood all week. It doesn't mean she smelled badly, hopefully not, but a foul mood means a bad mood, so that when somebody says something to her, she snaps. What do you want? What do you want? Or you just don't bother going near her at all because she's got a face like thunder. Yeah, so somebody not really so happy with life at that time. So she's in a foul mood. What has you in such a foul mood? The sun is shining. It's a lovely day. Ah, don't talk to me. I'm really in a foul mood. I have been all week. So to be in a foul mood. Number 14, hostile. Okay, so when we talk about hostile, it means something that is the enemy. So hostile situation, okay? Or we can have hostile language. So let me give you the examples. We didn't want our company to be sold to the opposition. It was a hostile takeover. So we weren't in favor of the takeover. We would prefer to have the company separate and independent, but the offer was too good to turn down for the shareholders. So they accepted it, but it was a hostile takeover. So something hostile is something that is against the other people. Yeah, hostile Indians, all the great cowboy and Indian movies that I used to watch when I was a young guy, the Indians would be described as hostile Indians, and they were only defending their own land, the land that these Americans had thrown them off. Yeah, so, but they were described as hostile. Yeah, so a crowd demonstrating on the streets outside the parliament buildings, if they're demonstrating against high cost of living, inflation. The reporter might say a hostile crowd gathered outside parliament buildings, waving placards and shouting abuse at all of the government ministers as they entered government buildings, a hostile crowd. Her language is strong and aggressive. She was hostile towards me from the very beginning. So perhaps somebody you just didn't get on so well with, hostile. Ingenious. His invention was simple, but wonderful and clever. It was ingenious. He had an ingenious solution to the problem. Something very simple, something easy to understand, but nobody else had thought about it. And yeah, ingenious. Some of these apps that you see on our mobile phones these days, ingenious. All something that makes life far, far easier. How to find your lost keys, how to find your car in a car park, how to find your luggage in the airport. Ingenious. Yeah, so really, really good ideas. Number 16, harsh. Again, we have a couple of ways in which we can use this. We can talk about somebody's language being a little bit harsh, or the words they use to us as being a little bit harsh, or indeed we can talk about the weather also as harsh. He lives in Glasgow. 9 months of the year, the weather is really harsh, wet, cold and windy. So for those 9 months, no matter whether it's June or it's September, you have to wear a coat and a scarf all of the time. It's the weather conditions are harsh if you're not used to them, very harsh. But sometimes the language we use can be harsh when we insult somebody or we talk very strongly to somebody. So perhaps we're a little bit annoyed or frustrated with them. And when we finish talking to them, they go off really very, very upset. And your partner might say to you, I think you were a little bit harsh with the children. You didn't need to be so strong with them. It would have been enough just to tell them not to do it again. Okay, so a harsh lesson. So if we're, you know, when perhaps our teachers take the mobile phone away from us, it's a harsh lesson. We told you, you cannot use the mobile phones in class. So when you do use it, well, it's going to be taken from you and you won't get it for a week. So that's a harsh lesson, one of life's harsh lessons. Be careful with the pronunciation. Harsh, a harsh lesson. Number 17, jinxed. When something is jinxed, it means that it's not likely to work, and it's something that even whoever touches it, it's going to break. Ah, that dishwasher, it's jinxed. Every time you put some dishes into it and you switch it on, it works 1 minute, then 2 minutes later it stops working. It's completely jinxed. Okay, so there's something wrong with it, but we don't know what it is. Or perhaps you are jinxed. Every time you buy something new, a mobile phone, you end up taking it back to the shop the next day. So no matter what you buy, there's something breaks down. Your laptop. Remember when you bought your laptop, after 2 weeks, you had to get it replaced. Remember when you got the new mobile phone, there was no battery in the box, so you had to wait to get the battery delivered. Remember when we had the television and after 2 days it just stopped working and nobody knew why? Ah, yeah, he said, I think I'm jinxed. Every time I buy some electrical equipment, it doesn't work. I'll just give up. You can buy it in future. So when you're jinxed, it means that something always seems to go wrong with something you buy or something you do. Doesn't really mean that everything, but it just appears that way, to be jinxed. The government was jinxed from the beginning. There's going to be another election in 3 months. So nothing worked. The negotiations they had with the unions didn't work. The coalition they had arranged with the other parties broke down. So the government was jinxed from the very start, and there'll be another election in 3 months. Okay, now we're on to number 18. We've got three to go. Number 18, persuasive. Persuasive. Okay, so somebody who is persuasive is somebody who can usually get other people to do something that he wants them to do, okay, or she wants them to do. He can be very persuasive when he wants to be. A few good, well-chosen words from him and people usually do what he wants, okay? He could be very persuasive and get people to do what he wanted them to do. So that's the example. His arguments were very persuasive. When he was finished, everybody was in agreement. So, you know, if you were having a debate or discussion, let's say about climate control, and everybody was in favor of the reasons why climate control was needed and all the climate change, but somebody with opposite and views and opinions stood up and his arguments were very persuasive. And at the end of it, you would actually have to think that, yeah, perhaps it's not all true what they say about the reasons for climate change. So he could be very persuasive, or his arguments could be very persuasive, or the words he used could be very persuasive. So he could get you to think the way he wanted you to think, get you to do the things that he wanted you to do. Now we have tedious. This is number 19, tedious. And tedious means something very small and difficult and complicated and takes a long, long time. So for example, doing a jigsaw puzzle with 500 or 600 little pieces to it, extremely tedious. One of my grandchildren got for Christmas a year or so ago, a jigsaw puzzle with over 500 pieces, and he asked me, could I help him? Oh my God, it took me forever. Very, very tedious, very tiring, very difficult, not so complicated, but just all these tiny little pieces that you have put together. So somebody's work can be tedious, lots of small, boring little details to be completed. So if you're updating a computer system, if you're inputting data, it's not difficult, it's not rocket science, but it is tedious because you've got to make sure you get all the numbers, all the names, everything has to be put in on the new system so it can be recorded and saved and backed up. The guest speaker gave a tedious lecture with lots of numbers and data and very uninteresting facts. So you're sitting in a lecture waiting for it to finish. Wow, this is so tedious. It's like watching paint dry. And then finally, number 20, and again, be careful with the pronunciation on this word, unscrupulous, unscrupulous. So when somebody is unscrupulous, it means that they have no morals. They don't really care what they do, what they say. They just really want to make another sale. So often, not always, you have to be very careful about generalizing, but car dealers, second-hand car dealers, are often described as being unscrupulous. Yeah, an unscrupulous car dealer didn't tell the purchaser that the car had been in two previous accidents. So he bought the car, but he wasn't told when he bought it that it had been in two previous accidents, and he only discovered it when he sent it in to be repaired some weeks later. Okay, so an unscrupulous car dealer sold him the car without telling him about the history of the prior history of the car. An extremely unscrupulous sales manager sold the product without providing any guarantee whatsoever. There's supposed to be a minimum 12-month guarantee, but no 12-month guarantee was provided. So the unscrupulous sales manager sold the product without offering or providing the 12-month guarantee that should have been provided. Okay, so that's the adjective unscrupulous. So there you have it. We've got 20 advanced adjectives. And adjectives, as I said, are for describing nouns. I haven't used any of the ordinary adjectives, big, small, bad, little, long, whatever. We've given you 20 advanced adjectives, and it would be really great if you could try and practice some of them. Take them, take the examples that I've given, try to make your own examples to practice them. There are 20, so it's going to take you a bit of time to get through them. And don't worry if you forget some of them. Just try to remember three or four and then move on from that and drop them into your speech from time to time. And if you need any more help, any other help, you know where I am. Just come back to me. Okay, so this is Harry thanking you for listening, thanking you for watching, and giving you just a gentle reminder to join me again for the next lesson.